In this video, we're gonna create this sliced text effect using Apple Motion for Final Cut Pro. And as always, if you're a patron, you can download this motion template and use it in your videos right now. Opening Apple Motion, if you don't get the project browser, you can always come up to File and then select New from Project Browser. The first thing we're gonna do is select the Final Cut title. Over here on the right side, you can set your preset and frame rate to whatever you typically like to edit with in Final Cut Pro, and your duration you can leave somewhere at 10 seconds. After that, we'll push open. When we first open up a title project, it will have this type text here and title background layer. Go ahead and just delete those. From there, we're gonna go ahead and add in our own title layer. So we'll just select the text tool, which we can also get with T. Then we can click anywhere in our viewer and type in whatever word we want. After that, we'll go over to the inspector and scale it up to a place where we're happy. I like where 288 looks. And we can also set the alignment to be centered, go to our properties, and reset the position so it is directly in the middle. After that, I'm gonna right click and create a new group. With our first group, we'll just label it as bottom slice. The secondary group that we just created we'll call top slice. Selecting our subscribe text layer, go ahead and press K. This is going to create a clone layer, which means that any changes we apply to the subscribe text layer will apply to that clone layer, which can come in handy if we were to change the scale or the color of the text. Go ahead and drag that clone layer up into our top slice group. Next, we need to create the slice. So let's find our bottom slice layer, right click and select Add Image Mask. After that, I'm gonna come down and find my shape tool, and we're gonna create a Bezier shape by using the Bezier tool here. You can also get that with B. Zooming out, we can go ahead and just create a rough slice shape going across the entire screen. Then we'll go ahead and close it off so it's a contained shape, just like so. You can make adjustments to these points as you find necessary. I'm pretty happy with that. From there, we'll label the Bezier shape as the mask layer. Then we can just click and drag that into the image mask. Now, it's super important that the image mask is applied to the group that contains the text. If we apply this image mask directly onto the text, the clone layer is also going to receive that mask, and we definitely do not want that. So I'm gonna undo that and make sure that this image mask is applied onto the group containing the text. We want this clone title layer, which I'll rename as cloned title. We want this clone to receive the same mask that's being applied to this original text layer, but we want the complete opposite of that. So one way to do that is to go ahead and select our mask, and we're gonna push K to create yet again another clone layer. And this is a clone of that mask, which means if we change this mask in any way, those changes will also apply to the clone layer. We'll rename this to be cloned mask, and we'll just drag this into the top slice group. After that, we can right click on the top slice and select add image mask, and we can go ahead and drag this cloned mask into that image mask well. Now, as it is, both masks are acting in the exact same way. This is very easy to fix. We'll just come on over to the left side and select invert mask. So now we should have a bottom slice and a top slice. But what's great is because we have these clone layers, I can go into my subscribe text and type in whatever I want. And both groups are gonna receive those changes but still retain the slice. So this is a great way of future-proofing this project so you can use it over and over again for your videos. Additionally, at any time if we ever wanted to change the slice shape, we can select the mask, double click on it, and now I can just drag these red lines to whichever direction I want, and that will update and apply to both layers. Now I want these slice layers to come in together all as one singular object, but right now as it is, if we were to animate these, we'd have to animate them individually, and that could be quite frustrating. So let's just put them both into a singular group. To do that, we'll collapse both these layers. We'll right click, create a new group, and then I'm just gonna drag both of these other groups into that singular group. We could rename this group to be the animator group or whatever you really wanna call it. So now I can move both layers together, or if I want to move them separately, I'll just select each individual layer here inside of the animator group. Now, another thing that I wanna set up is you'll notice that a lot of the slice text presets out there tend to have both the text objects moving in separate directions. Again, we could manually do that, but there's a much easier way inside of Motion. First, let's find the top slice group. We'll go to Properties and find the position. We can right click on that position and select Add Parameter Behavior, and we're going to link the top layer to the bottom layer. Finding that link parameter, we'll go ahead and just click and drag the bottom slice group into this well. So now wherever the bottom slice moves, that top slice is going to move. But we actually want them to move in the complete opposite direction. And that's where the negate parameter applies. Again, selecting that top slice group, we'll go to the position, right click, and we're going to add another parameter behavior. And this time we're going to select negate. So with this first link parameter, we are linking up both objects, so they're receiving the same values as it moves around on the screen. But the negate parameter is then going to subtract whatever that motion is. So we're essentially making them move in opposite directions. So you'll see that as I click and drag one layer, the other layer is moving in the complete opposite direction. This is gonna make animation super easy down the road. Now that we have that set up, we can go ahead and collapse this top slice and select our animator group. Now I want everything to move from the bottom of the screen up towards the middle. So let's drag this down to the bottom. We can click to add a keyframe and let's move forward about 1 second on the timeline. From there, we can just type in 0 into our Y value so it moves back into the middle of the frame. But I'm not very happy with this animation. It doesn't feel very kinetic. To fix that, let's jump inside of our keyframe editor. You'll notice that our keyframes are just a straight linear line. We definitely want to fix that. So let's select this first frame and you'll notice that we have this little handle. I'm gonna press shift while clicking that handle and just drag it to the left-hand side. We can also select this secondary handle down here at the bottom. Holding shift, we'll drag it directly to the right. So we're gonna create a very sharp S shape. And let's just see what that does to our animation. That's looking super nice and kinetic. But I also want this text to be revealed. So we're gonna need to add a mask for that. To do that, let's go ahead and collapse our animator group. We'll right click, create a new group, and drag the animator group into that secondary group. Let's call this the mask group. Now the reason that I'm creating these groups and then dragging the layers into that group is that if I were instead to just right click directly on this group and create a group, it can offset the center anchor point, which is really annoying to deal with. So by creating an entirely new group and then dragging everything into that, it's going to keep the anchor point directly in the center. Just a handy little tip that's gonna save you a lot of trouble down the road with your other motion projects. Okay. Back to this masking. So we want to mask everything and have it hiding when it's down here at the bottom. Very simply, select the mask group and we'll go ahead and find our masking tool. We'll just use the rectangle and we'll just click and drag across the frame to a place where we don't want to be seeing the subscribe text. After that, we're just gonna come over to the left side and select invert mask. So now that text is going to pop up from nothing right here in the center. And it looks really nice. Now, once again, why do we create an entirely new group rather than applying this mask onto the animator? Well, if we applied that mask to that animator, the mask would move up with the text, which would be really annoying. So by creating an entirely new group, this mask is going to stay in place. So we have our text flying up. All the groups have been prepared to be split apart. So now it's time to actually split it. Let's go on over into our animator group and find the bottom layer. Let's move forward about 1 second on our timeline. Now, we could manually animate everything. That is a very viable option, but I love using parameter behaviors whenever possible inside of motion. With our bottom group selected, we'll go up to behaviors, go to basic motion, and we're gonna select motion path. You'll notice if I zoom out here that the motion path is giving us two control points here on the screen. I can drag this secondary point to wherever I want that object to move to. Now you'll notice that this motion path is over the entire duration of the project. So again, having our playhead at the first second with the motion parameter behavior selected, we'll push I. Then we can move forward a few frames, maybe 10 frames, and push O. So now this animation will take place over 10 seconds. We'll move our playhead past the animation point and then move this to the final position where we want the animation to finish off. So somewhere in here is looking pretty good to me. Again, our animation is not very dynamic and I want to fix that. So let's come on over here to the left side and find the speed parameter. It's set to constant, which means it's going to be a linear animation. Let's go ahead and just set that to custom. Again, if we take a look at our keyframe editor, we'll see that we have a straight line here, but we can select this secondary control point, grab the handle, and again, we'll just make that S curve. Then we can find the first control point, holding shift, and drag that to the right. So now we should have a nice kinetic animation that takes place splitting our text apart. And what's great is if we want to adjust the duration of this animation, we just have to find our motion path here and drag that out to the right. So now it's slower. Or if we want to speed it up, drag it over to the left. So by setting up these different parameters ahead of time, we can jump into this motion project at any time and shift these parameters really easily. So as it is, everything pops into place and then it splits apart, and that is looking really nice. But there's a few extra layers of polish we could add to this to take it to the next level. One thing is to add some shards shooting off as it's broken apart. This is very easy to do with particle emitters inside of Motion. So again, let's go ahead and collapse all of the layers, including the mask layer, and we'll create an entirely new group. I'm gonna push Command Shift N to do so. And we could just call this shards. With the shards group selected, let's find the shape tool and we'll just create a little simple triangle. Let's rename that to be the original shard. Then going over to the position, I like to just center this up. It doesn't really matter, but I just find it's a little bit cleaner. We'll have the original shard selected and go over to make particles. And immediately you'll start to notice that we got a bunch of particles shooting off. Let's go over to the left side and change the shape. Right now they're emitting from a singular point and we want them to emit from the text. So we'll go ahead and click on point and change it over to image. Then we can go ahead and just drag in our mask layer. And so now it's going to only emit from wherever that text is inside of our project. You'll also notice this emission alpha slider. I recommend you just drag that up to 100%. That means that particles would be able to emit from any place that has an alpha channel as well, and we definitely don't want that. Also, the arrangement is currently a tile fill, and we want to randomize this a bit. So let's change this over to random fill, and now those points can be coming from anywhere. Also, I'll drag the emitter up just a little bit because it seems to be offset from our original text group. Now that we've done that, let's go ahead and turn on 3D so that it can emit in all three directions, not just X and Y, but also the Z direction. Then we'll scroll on down and find the birth rate. I'm actually going to set this birth rate down to 0. Let's find the point in our timeline where we want the particles to start emitting. So somewhere right in here at the peak of the animation. I'm liking that point right there. So that's about 1 second and 6 frames for me. Then I'm gonna select the emitter and push I to trim it down. That means this is gonna be the start point of that emitter. From there, we'll find the initial number. Right now it's set to 0, which means there is gonna be 0 particles on the first frame, but we can just drag this up to something like 30 or so. And that means we're gonna have 30 particles at the start. So right at that moment, those particles will be created. Scrolling further down, we can adjust stuff like life randomness. And the big one is speed. Let's drag the speed slider way up so that these particles are a lot faster. And we'll also drag up the speed randomness. This is just gonna add some variation to the different particles, giving us an even better result. After that, we'll find the angle and drag that up. Angle randomness, drag that one up a lot. And then the spin. We want all of these particles to be spinning as they're shooting off, so we'll drag that up. And the spin randomness, I'm gonna drag this way up so that some of these particles can be spinning like crazy. Next, these particles seems to be a little bit too big, so let's bring this scale down quite a bit, and then we'll bring up the scale randomness. And that is looking pretty good. But a lot of these particles are kind of blipping out of existence, and we definitely don't want that. So let's find the opacity over life. We'll expand that out, and then we'll just add a secondary point to this opacity slider and drag that to 0. So now over time, they're going to fade out as they're dying, which looks really nice. And one last little bit of flair is I like to add gravity to these particles so they look just a little bit more real and grounded in the project. So let's select our emitter. We'll go to behaviors, we'll go to simulations, and then we're gonna select gravity. After that, we could drag this gravity slider up quite a bit. I actually happen to like how it looks beyond 100. Maybe we'll bring that up to somewhere like 567, and we can see how those particles are exploding off of the subscribe text. So if we were to push play, this is our final result. And what's really incredible is it's fully dynamic. So for example, if I wanted to go into my subscribe text and change this over to sliced text, everything would update and we could go ahead and push play and it will pop off just as it should. At any time, we could adjust the final animation point, just like so. And of course, you can go in and play with the emitter and have all sorts of controls like that. If you wanted to send this over to Final Cut Pro, you would just push Command S and save it as a new template. Then you could go in and edit the text and everything should update. Don't forget, if you're a patron, you'll be able to download this project. I'm gonna add some easy on-screen controls so you can adjust all these parameters and the slice line as you need it, which is gonna be super powerful. And massive thanks to my Patreon subscribers for supporting the channel. If this video was helpful to you, consider pressing that like button, consider subscribing, and you may wanna check out this video where I show you how to build an audio animation over in Apple Motion. Thank you so much for watching, and I cannot wait to see you in the next one.